I would like to welcome you to this online worship service at Trinity Lutheran Church in Bellingham, Washington. We are in the season of Lent yet, but our scripture passages for today really focus on the compassion that God has for us and how he makes all things new, even our relationship with him. This moves us all the more to praise him. And so I invite you to join with us as we lift up our voice in praise to our Creator and our Savior. Gather in the name of our forgiving God. He chose to reveal himself to us by using the word Father. May we preserve the positive image of that name by the ways in which we live with our families. We gather in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It is he who has revealed the Father to us. It is he through whom the will of the Father is done. We gather in the name of God, the Holy Spirit. May his presence among us purify our hearts, open our minds to the scriptures, and strengthen our faith. Amen. You are all children of God through faith in Christ Jesus. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. God's love for us is great. What makes it so remarkable is that it is not something we have earned, nor something that we deserve. On the contrary, because of our rebellion against the Lord, we should only receive his wrath. But God is merciful to us. He holds before us this promise in Scripture. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Heavenly Father, we are often like the two lost sons in Jesus' parable. Like the younger son, we walk away from you and the way you would have us live. We take the blessings and talents we have and squander them. Father, sometimes we are like the older son. We fail to see our own sin and your forgiveness to us, and would rather judge others and withhold our forgiveness from them. Except for the grace you work in us, our hearts and lives are sinful. Forgive us, Lord, for the sake of your true and faithful Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. As a called and ordained servant of the Word, I invite you to believe God's promise. Your sins are forgiven for Christ's sake. As forgiven children, celebrate now the Father's love and your new life in Jesus Christ. Amen. Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, your justice like the great deep. How priceless is your unfailing love. Both high and low among men, find refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house. You give them drink from your river of delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light, we see light. Continue your love to those who know you, your righteousness to the upright in heart. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Beloved Father, when we have strayed, you have welcomed us home time and time again. By your grace, keep us from our foolish ways. Fold us in your loving arms and open our own arms to love and forgive our brothers and sisters. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord. Amen.
The New Testament lesson comes from the 5th chapter of 2 Corinthians. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ, and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he has committed us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to the 15th chapter of St. Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him. And the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. There was a man who had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me." And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine rose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into his fields to feed the pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but perish, I hear, with young hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion, and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, 'Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf, because he has received him back safe and sound.' But he was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him. But he answered his father, 'Look, these many years I have served you, and I never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me the young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who had devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him.' And he said to him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It is fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found.' This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ."
Let us now confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Jesus is fairer,
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God, our Heavenly Father, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear again these wonderful words from St. Paul, which also apply to you and me today. He writes, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them, and he has committed to us the message of reconciliation." Now, before I talk about how God has made us new creations in Christ and how that has also changed our relationship, not just with our Creator, but with others, I would like to talk about what happens here on earth. Often, what we experience here on earth is dramatically portrayed in books and movies, and as well as in musicals and plays. They vividly portray the joys that we experience in life, along with the tragedies. I would like you to think about the musical West Side Story. It was first performed on Broadway, I believe, in 1957. It was made into a movie in 1961, and just last year, remade and released into the theaters. Maybe you have seen it. This musical, The West Side Story, is based on William Shakespeare's play, Romeo and Juliet, and it explores the rivalry between two street gangs of different ethnic backgrounds. Yet in the midst of the hostility and loathing that these gangs have for the other gangs, there's a relationship of love that develops between Tony and Maria, who of course come from different backgrounds. And throughout the musical, the tension continues to build. What will happen to Tony and Maria? Will they escape this killing zone? Will they be able to change the hearts of the gangs? Will they live happily ever after, or will tragedy strike? But as you know, just as Romeo and Juliet ended in tragedy, so also the musical West Side Story ends with death. Tragedies are not my favorite genre of movies, books, or musicals. And one of the reasons for this is because I see truly heart-wrenching things happening in life all the time. Why emphasize it in a musical or play when all you need to do is turn on the news? How can your heart not be moved as you see the carnage that is happening because of the war in Ukraine? Or maybe when famine hits other places around the world and you see people in dire straits. But you don't have to look halfway around the world to see tragedies happening. There's also violence and gunfights in our own streets. West Side Story is not just some fantasy tale that has no basis in reality. Gangs exist in our country. People from rival groups seek to extend their power over others, and they seek to destroy their enemies. And they don't seem to care if people are hurt, even if they be innocent children. For those of us who take the Bible seriously, we believe that the devil is at work in this world. He seeks to destroy God's creation and his plan for the world. And the fighting that we observe is evidence that people are not loving their neighbor as themselves. It is evidence that they are following more so the desires of Satan, who seeks to bring misery and pain into this world. He wields his influence. In fact, This crafty one started it when he tempted humans to turn away from their Creator. He sought to get Adam and Eve into thinking that God was not for them, but against them. He sought to get them to rebel against God. This would mean that they would see God as their adversary and not as a compassionate father. And Satan succeeded when they gave in to temptation and sinned. They no longer had complete peace with God. Now, I would like to bring up a couple of things, three things in particular. First of all, God does not change. God was always a loving heavenly father to Adam and Eve. And even after they sinned, the Lord showed his mercy by sacrificing an animal so that they could cover themselves. And God continues to be a compassionate heavenly father today. God does not change. Second thing, it is not that God made sinful human beings into his enemies, but rather it's the other way around. Humans made God into their enemy when they resisted him and his will. And third, it is only God who can change the situation, who can bring about peace. We cannot make ourselves God's friends. We cannot make peace with God. But the good news is that in Jesus Christ, God does it. He makes us new creations, and with that comes a new relationship with him. Now, as my message continues, I would like you to consider the parable of the lost sons from the gospel lesson for today in light of the three points that I just made. The first point is that God doesn't change. In the parable, there's a father that had two sons. You see dramatic changes in the sons. However, the father always remains the same. He is compassionate when the younger son wants to leave. He is compassionate when the younger son returns home. And the father also shows great mercy when he visits the older son who doesn't want to return home because his younger brother is there. Just like God, the father in this parable remains the same. However, that was not true for his sons. Both sons fought against the father's will. That means they treated their father as their adversary. When the younger son wanted his inheritance now, it was a great insult to his father. He basically said, "Father, I don't care about you. All I want is your money." Children normally receive their inheritance once their parents die. In my mind, one of the most hurtful and sickening things a child could ever say to a caring parent is, "I wish you were dead." Yet that is what the younger son wanted. People in this sinful world wish that their enemies were dead. And in this parable, that is what the younger son wanted of his father. He acted like his father was his adversary, his enemy. Yet how does his father react? Does he kick him out of his home and, you know, write him out of his will? No, he continues to show undeserved compassion, and he gives the younger son his inheritance. The younger son leaves, but notice how when he returned, the father also showed great mercy, receiving him back not as a slave or a servant, but as a beloved son. Now, it was not just the younger son in this parable that insulted the father. When the younger son returned, the father put on a great celebration. This was a community event. Everyone was welcome. However, the older son remained outside. He refused to join the celebration, going directly against what his father wanted. He was acting as an adversary to his father, as an enemy. Nevertheless, the father goes out to him and shows him great compassion. He declares to his older son, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. Yet it was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive." Was dead and now alive? That sounds a lot like what St. Paul writes in Corinthians. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. And of course, all this is from God, who has reconciled us, brought about peace with us through Jesus Christ. I love this passage from 2 Corinthians, as well as the parable of the two lost sons, because it tells us about who our God is like, as well as the joy that we have because of Jesus Christ. We need to remember that God is always the same. He is a compassionate Heavenly Father. However, you and I are not always the same. At times, we rebel against God. We set him up as our adversary when we resist how he has called us to live with self-control, peace, and patience with one another. We follow more so the will, unfortunately, of Satan at times as we seek to undermine relationships. And yet God remains the same. And God's love continues to come to us through his Son, Jesus Christ, bringing about peace through the forgiveness of sins that God continues to show you and me. Our lives are different because of Jesus Christ. Even though we sin, God continues to forgive us, making us new, raising us to new life, giving us and restoring that relationship as his sons and daughters. In fact, every time we gather with other Christians on Sunday, it is a great celebration as we remember that God welcomes us into his family. But it is not something that we are just to keep to ourselves. The love of God moves us to be ambassadors of reconciliation. God is full of compassion, and he desires that everyone would look to Jesus Christ, trust in him, and see their Creator not as their adversary, but as their compassionate Heavenly Father. In other words, God desires that you and I talk to others about Jesus. And as we do, God does an amazing thing. He changes people's hearts. The musical West Side Story reminds us of the hatred that is in this world. But the scripture lessons which we read earlier in the service and which I've talked about in my message remind us of the great compassion that God has for us as well as for all people. God makes us new each and every day. We are no longer his enemies. We have peace with him. We are part of his family. This is a message which we are to always treasure, but it's also a message that we are to share with others. Amen. Once again, thank you for watching this online worship service. If you have a concern, or maybe even a joy you would like to share, please give a call to the church office, or you can always reach me on my cell phone. We continue now with our prayers. Almighty God, we pray for those who have strayed from the truth and who have wandered away from you. Through your word and spirit, bring them to repentance. Help them to see you as their loving Father, ready to welcome them. Grant to the body of Christ, the church, faithful and bold pastors church workers, and lay leaders. Help us all to be your voice, hands, and feet to proclaim that gospel good news here and around the world. We pray for the industry of our country, for those who provide employment, and for those who raise crops and herds. Bless the efforts of all who seek to provide help for others in need. We pray for our president, for our governors, and for all public servants. Grant that they may be strengthened in every good deed. Give wisdom and hearts filled with love for people to those whose responsibility it is to lead our country. Grant wisdom to judges and juries and those who desire to bring justice in our courts. Lord of hosts, protect those who serve in the armed forces and our law enforcement agencies. Give them courage as they carry out their duties. In our prayers for today, we continue to lift up Donna and Bill, Barry, baby Cora, along with Jack, Ryan, Mike, Henry, Teresa, Jack, and we also think of those whose lives have been turned upside down because of the war in Ukraine, those suffering, those who are refugees, as well as those who have lost loved ones. We ask that you would be with all people who are in need, sending relief, strength, and healing according to your will. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Faithful Lord, with me abide. I share.